My name is Leanne Musser, and I'm the college coordinator here at North Campus. And this program is our back-to-back presentation, where we will have two programs this evening, the first of which is our NCAA presentation. This is going to go from roughly 6 to 7. Then there'll be about a 15-minute break, and then we will have a presentation on highly selective colleges. We certainly know that playing athletics in college is a terrific opportunity, as well as a very, very large commitment. We want to make sure that all those who are interested in participating in athletics know what they need to know to be prepared for eligibility, for the commitment itself, and certainly for the coursework and preparation that they need for the sport. We are very fortunate that we have Kevin Coy and Brad Kane from Homewood Flossmoor, who have extensive experience not only as athletes, but coaches, and very much requested NCAA speakers. So I am very pleased that they are willing to speak with you this evening. So without further ado, Kevin Coy and Brad Kane.
Thanks, Leanne. Good evening. First of all, thanks for coming. Like Leanne mentioned, my name is Brad, and Kevin is my co-partner. Just a little bit about us and how we got to stand in front of you today and our background. Myself, I competed in Division II track at Lewis University. I was not a runner, I was too slow, I was a pole vaulter. I was not smart enough when they asked me to put that pole in my hand and fly through the air. Kevin had some extensive background in athletics as well. You want to maybe mention your background?
Sure. As Brad said, I'm Kevin Coy, and my experience comes from as well track and field. However, I was not like Brad. I wasn't brave enough to be up 16 feet in the air, so I put my 2 feet on the ground and ran as fast as I could, put one foot in front of the other. So I was a Division I recruit, and for many different reasons, I ended up going Division III. I wanted to compete in football, and I wanted to compete in track as well. Wasn't sure what sport I wanted to give up. Had a few Division II schools look at me for football. I wanted to play tailback. My senior year, I was 5'7", 160 pounds. I don't think I was going to play tailback at a Division I school. So I was smart enough to know that, okay, let me give some other opportunities. Let's see what happens. And happened to stumble upon a small little Division III school that is very close, near and dear to my heart, and Brad knows that because I speak about it quite often. So, I've had the luxury of, like I said before, being recruited by Division I, Division II, Division III, working for a Division II institution, also a Division III institution, and then both Brad and I get to work with numerous Division I, Division II recruited, Division III recruited athletes at our school, HF.
So Kevin and I, as Kevin mentioned, worked on the admission side for a couple years as well. After my time running track at Lewis, they asked me if I'd like to stick around, and I worked admissions at Lewis. And as we traveled around evening programs, college fairs, someone stood next to me for a long time at Loris College, and that was Kevin. Now, the story goes that Kevin says he remembers me. Unfortunately, I don't know if I remember him. So hopefully I left a good impression on him at that point. I stayed at Lewis for 2 years. I headed over to Homewood Flossmoor High School. At that point, Kevin followed me, took my job at Lewis, from Loris to Lewis. Shortly after that, headed over to Lincoln Way High School. And then we stole him from Lincoln Way High School back over to HF. So amongst that time, like Kevin has said, we worked with hundreds of athletes and gone through the process ourselves. We presented it at our state conference. We do these evening programs as well. I'll be the first one to tell you, I don't have all the answers. We'll give you as much as we can tonight. If there's questions that you have at the end of the program, we'd be happy to stick around and answer those for you. You will have our email addresses. You will have our phone numbers. Feel free to call us with questions. If we don't know, we have other friends that do these presentations as well, and we call them to bounce those ideas off. Question already? Hard to hear? Do I need to yell louder on the microphone? Do I? Okay. I felt like it was loud, so I apologize for that. Better? Okay. Can you hear me now? Whoa. Better? Okay. All right, so we'll begin here. Tonight, the gist of our program is to give you a quick snapshot of all the information that you're going to need to know. If you want us to go farther into something, like I said, at the end, we'd be happy to do that. We start with the basics, assuming that we're all at the same level. I know there's some that are going to be a little bit more advanced, but we'll work through this. We'll talk about the different opportunities, Division I, Division II, and Division III, what they mean. Also talk about shortly about NAIA and the NCAA, and each of those requirements and what it takes to play at those levels.
We'll start off with the NJCAA, which is the National Association for Junior Colleges. So a snapshot of that, 510 members, institutions across 24 regions. There are 16 sports in which national championships are conducted. And this is where students, for many different reasons, they may go to a junior college or community college and maybe to further their skills, but athletic scholarships are involved within the junior colleges. With the eligibility, pretty much they just need to graduate from a high school with an academic diploma or a GED. So non-high school graduates, they have one term of college work, passing 12 hours with at least a 1.75 GPA. So if a student athlete has not earned enough credits from a high school graduation, he or she may not be eligible to compete with the class that they've graduated with. So this is probably, I would say, probably the easiest qualifications to get into. So this is where a lot of different opportunities will happen with student athletes who may be looking for that Division I opportunity, may not have gotten that Division I opportunity, so they'll elect to go to the junior college route.
It's a really important point. When we start talking with students and our families, and it's something I think we all need to be aware of. We need to be very wise and smart about competing in college athletics. We know that not every student athlete is going to be a Division I athlete. There's a really good, in the book that you have in front of you, the yellow covered one, there's a good breakdown, if you haven't seen it already, how many students actually matriculate from high school athletics onto high school, college athletics, onto professional athletics. And I think you have to be mindful that there are other options out there besides Division I, Division II. And I hope you see that throughout the slideshows tonight. And there's some really good opportunities that students sometimes miss out on because they don't think of some of the other levels out there. So always be aware of those other opportunities.
Go ahead.
Next one up we have is the NAIA, which has 290 member institutions. There are 21 sports which compete national championships. And athletic scholarships are available at some institutions. This is going to vary from institution to institution. I can't blanket and say these are all of them. But if you visit the NAIA website, it will give you the information on what schools are at that level and what schools are not.
I would probably throw in as well, this is one of the more prominent or becoming more largely attended institutions. A lot of families may be looking for that NCAA Division I, Division II opportunity, and an NAIA institution will come into play. So some of those examples, and we'll jump to that in a second, but schools like St. Xavier, who has a wonderful football team, St. Francis, which also has a wonderful football team, St. Ambrose out in Iowa, they're NAIA schools, and a lot of these students are going through the process and maybe not knowing that those schools are NAIA schools, and then going through that process, finding out that they are NAIA schools. And there is a process with the NAIA as well that we'll talk about.
I think the other piece is that financial piece. Obviously, being an athlete in college, you want to also remember that there's that reimbursement for the scholarships. So we have families come in and say, well, the student really, family needs a scholarship. He's pretty good at sports, or she's pretty good at sports. Maybe not Division I or II. We'll get into Division III and the lack of scholarships there athletically. But NAIA can be a great tool to help fund some of that education as well.
I think the benefit of the NAIA with some of these schools is, like Brad said, there's athletic scholarships available, but a lot of those schools are also they have more of that feel of a Division III institution, smaller classroom atmosphere, getting to know the professors, things like that. But you get the athletic scholarships available as well.
Some of the eligibility requirements, they must have graduated from high school. They must be accepted as well with that university. Two of the following requirements, 18 on the ACT or 860, and a minimum overall high school grade point average of at least a 2.0 on a 4-point scale. And or also graduate in the top half of class. Two of those three must be met in order to qualify.
So this is a nice opportunity for those students who may not necessarily meet the NCAA requirements, still want to compete at a still compete and receive a scholarship, the NAIA is another opportunity for them because, again, as Brad said, they only have to meet two of those three requirements.
Kevin always gets angry with me. I start jumping ahead in slides, and I'm going to start it off on our third slide already. But you're going to see in a few minutes here, NCAA Division I, Division II has really started to up standards, and they're changing in 2016. And we'll get into what those are, but it really sets a higher standard for those students to be eligible. So if you're on the bubble line or, you know, in jeopardy of not receiving those scholarships in Division I or Division II, maybe another great outlet for you. They do have the Eligibility Center, which is going to certify the student, make sure they are eligible. It's a $70 fee. And it's also separate from the NCAA. So a new thing came up a few years ago. I don't remember, fall of 2010, NAIA was missing out on all those dollars that NCAA was gathering as each student went through their clearinghouse. And they said, well, I think, you know, we need to get in part of that game. So now they also collect that donation as well.
Donation.
Yeah, really it is, not to get off topic, but all they're checking for is a 2.0 and then some ACT scores, and then they certify us and run that spot in. So what is the NCAA Eligibility Center? It used to be the clearinghouse. We've seen some changes over the years as the clearinghouse got a bad rap, and they said we need to change our name so everybody forgets about us, but nobody has forgot about them. In the guidance counseling world, they're the devil. And sometimes for families too. There's lots of requirements and hoops that we have to jump through. Core course requirements that Leanne or someone at the school has to take care of inputting each year to make sure that the students have the correct information that they need. But what they do is they actually certify academic transcripts, ACT scores, and SAT scores to make sure the student has met all the requirements. It's also a database for the coaches. Coaches can go into it once a student has done a student amateurism questionnaire. We'll talk about that in a few minutes as well. The family has done that, the coaches can then go in there and see statistics on the student as far as grade point average, ACT scores, to make sure that the student is eligible. The other thing that's new the past couple of years, it's now mandated that the schools have a compliance officer. So every university has an athletic program, Division I, Division II, and I'm not sure Division III if they're required or not.
I think Division I, Division
II. Division II has someone in the office that must double check the coaches so that students can't sneak in under the radar, and that someone is held accountable for that as well.
I guess I'll talk about Division III. There's Division III. This is the division where the most athletes are going to compete in the athletic competition. So there's 429 member institutions. As Brad mentioned earlier, there are no scholarships available for Division III. So obviously that's the biggest difference. I could go on a tangent forever, but I think coaches in Division III, a little bit more strategic in the way that they recruit, because if there's no scholarships offered, they've got to work a little bit harder to get those athletes to their institution. So, but there's 20 plus sports in which national championships are conducted. So I think one of the more prevalent that's coming up now is lacrosse. A lot of the colleges are starting to pick up lacrosse, especially Division III. These are some of the samples of Division III institutions: University of Chicago, Augustana out in Rock Island, Carthage up in Wisconsin, Elmhurst in Elmhurst, North Central out in Naperville, North Park, Wheaton, and the school that it holds near and dear to my heart, the finer institution of Loras College in Dubuque, Iowa. So those are some of the examples of Division III schools. With the initial eligibility, there is no initial eligibility for Division III. So as long as you're admitted into that Division III institution, you can compete for that school. Now, once that student athlete starts competing for the school, there's certain requirements that they'll have to meet, GPA requirements that they'll meet, and that's across the board for all Division III schools.
Some of the Division III schools you'll find try to make up a little bit for some of the scholarship money they're not able to get athletically. They'll try to find academic monies and things like that to help the families out. But absolutely no academics or athletic scholarships.
As I always tell families, if they want you, they'll find a way to get you.
Division II, as I mentioned earlier, that's Lewis and a couple other schools we talked about, was 291 institutions. Athletic scholarships are available. They go through the Eligibility Center. 20 sports and national championships. And the initial eligibility, like I mentioned, is certified by NCAA. I know I mentioned this earlier, I can't stress it enough. When I talk to students and we say Division II or Division III, they always put their heads down and say, you know, it's not good enough, or the athletes in there are subpar. I can tell you, just from my experience that I competed against, and I think Kevin would say the same exact thing, athletes that were just as good Division I as Division I athletes that I was competing with in Division II or even Division III. Some of the schools that Kevin has mentioned already are well known through the United States, and there's wonderful opportunities out there for school. I know I'm repeating for students, I know I'm repeating myself, but we can't stress it enough to our families. Sometimes they get so close-minded on just that one Division I school, and we want to make sure there's plenty of options for them. So the schools, of course, Lewis University right at the top of the list. University of Southern Indiana, Wisconsin Parkside, Grand Valley, and University of Illinois Springfield, just a few snap to look at. So in the past, in order to meet the eligibility, this is where some changes have begun to start in place, and they've upped the ante a little bit for the requirements. All they need to do is compete 14 core courses, and I know we're going to talk about this, but it's the first time we've seen it here, so I'm going to talk about core courses for a quick second. Core courses are defined by the NCAA as courses that they decide will count for eligibility. The courses that they decide right now for eligibility include math, English, science, social science, and foreign language. Those five areas are courses that are taken into the calculation to figure the grade point average. So whatever you see on a transcript right now, once the NCAA gets pulled, that will be torn apart. That means that gym classes are out, music classes, art classes, any elective class does not count towards that grade point average. So it's a really important part. As you go through this process with your student, please make sure you're working with your guidance counselors. I don't know, does the guidance counselors handle that, or do you, or both of you handle it? Okay. Make sure you're meeting with counselors to make sure that your students are taking the correct courses that will qualify them for the NCAA. On the NCAA website, you can actually go in there and look at what they are. The counselors have access to it, anyone has access to it. Based on your school code, or you can put the name of the school in there, and it will bring up the courses that are approved and not approved. So your core courses are 14. They were 14. You have to earn a 2.0 and that grade point average, and a combined SAT of 820 or ACT sum of 68. 68 comes out to about a 20.
No.
No. 18.
18.
18. Somewhere around an 18. So somewhere close. With that said, subscores from each test can be combined together. So what you do is taking subscores, adding them together to get at least at 68 and at 2.0. As you see some of the changes down at the bottom, the only big one is obviously the 16 core courses. So no longer is 14, it's now 16. Normally, if a student is doing what they're supposed to do throughout their time in high school, they're easily met. If you think about what you have here, I don't know exactly what you, but I know you have 4 years of English. You probably have 2 or 3 years of math requirement. You have, how many is it? Three. So you're similar to what we are. If a student follows on that track, they meet that requirement, no problem. Okay.
And has anybody heard of superscoring before? A couple of you guys have heard of superscoring. What that is they will take the highest subscore from any of the tests. They will add it together. That's where that 68 could come from. So what we tell students is every time you take the ACT, make sure to put the ACT or the NCAA code on the ACT. So that's definitely one of the benefits. The NCAA does try to take the best, they look at it and try to take care of the student the best that they can. So whatever helps them, whatever's more of an advantage to them, that's where this is going to come into play. Now with Division I, that's the meat and the potatoes. Everybody knows about these schools. These are the ones that are on TV every Saturday. They're now playing basketball and all other fun stuff during the weekdays. So there's 331 member institutions. Athletic scholarships are available. And there's 20 plus sports that compete for national championships, and obviously NCAA eligibility is gonna be required for this. Some of those institutions, our big school, our flagship school, University of Illinois and Urbana-Champaign, that's one of the big ones. A couple other ones are directional schools, Eastern, Western, Northern, Southern, and then Loyola, Northwestern, ISU. So those are a couple of the schools that are Division I institutions. With the eligibility, very similar to Division II eligibility. I think they pretty much mirror one another. So there's the requirements are to graduate from high school, complete 16 core courses, and earn a core course minimum GPA right now of a 2.0. And that corresponds with a sliding scale. So that's the difference with Division I and Division II. Division I is going to use a sliding scale. Division II is looking at that total sum score of the ACT.
You want to talk quickly about sliding scale?
Sure, absolutely. Go ahead.
Sliding scale is very simple. What it says is the higher that the ACT score is, the lower the grade point average can be, and vice versa. So the higher the grade point average, the lower the sum score of the ACT can be. That is in the information that you have in your packets as well. I don't know what page time, but if you flip through, you'll see the bunch of numbers on a page with grade point averages and ACT scores.
Now there's an early academic certification, so that's after six semesters, so that's through the junior year. So with that, with Division I, and actually Division II, they look pretty similar. 1,000 combined SAT or an 85 ACT sum score, 3.0 or higher, and in 13 core courses, including 3 in English, 2 in math, 2 in science, and 6 in any other core area, which could be, as Brad mentioned, foreign language. So Division II, pretty much the same requirements, they just need a 3.0 and the 12 core courses. So the difference with that one is the 5 other core areas. So if they meet those requirements, there's an early certification that students can get before their senior year. So a lot of families will ask, well, when can I start filling out the NCAA? Beforehand, we used to say wait until the senior year. I think college coaches are getting more and more aggressive with athletes. We have a senior basketball player, female basketball player, who's one of the top in the nation. And her sophomore year, we had Stanford coming in and talking to us about academics. So getting in, doing it as early as possible. I would probably say sophomore year is probably for those more elite athletes. That's sophomore year would probably be okay. You only have to fill out once, you only have to pay once, so as you go through your years, you just resend in your transcripts. So more students, more now than ever, are probably doing it their junior year. That's when recruiting really starts picking up with that. Brad jumped slides, so he already talked about the core courses, but this is just going over the core courses again. So again, that's English, math, science, social science, foreign language. Some of those elective credits could be some of those elective credits in the academic areas as well. So for example, we have psychology, things like that, classes like that, sociology. Those would count, even though they're considered elective courses, they're still counted as a social science.
I'm not sure the level of courses that you have. Do you have 2 levels or 3 levels as far as honors, maybe a regular college?
Several.
They must be at least regular academic level. I just give an example for us. We have academic core, college prep, honors, AP, IB. They must be at least at college prep level. So anything taught underneath that will flag the NCAA. We also always get the question, if my son or daughter has an IEP, how does that work? The NCAA will look at each case by case individually. So what they'll do is actually submit a copy of their IEP along with the course that the student will take. They will then comb through that to make sure that they've met the requirements that they consider them to be eligible or not.
Obtaining your school's list. So as Brad was talking about earlier, you can jump on the eligibility website, type in either your high school name or it's the CEEB code, ACT code, and it'll spit out a list of the NCAA approved courses. It's nice because you can also click on the courses that aren't approved, so you can go through your son or daughter's transcripts and see what classes they're taking, if they're approved or if they're not approved, and then you guys can actually start figuring out, okay, how many core courses is my son or daughter taking.
Liam, what is your CEEB code? In case somebody wants to write it down.
142-483.
Should be in the book.
They're in the book, okay.
Beautiful.
Very good.
Core course time limitation for Division I. There's 16 core courses that must be completed in 8 semesters, beginning with the first semester of 9th grade. So pretty much taking your core courses through high school, starting off at ninth grade. Some of the differences, there may be, and I don't know how you guys work, there may be foreign language that was taken in the junior high. If it's on the transcript, if it's given credit, the NCAA will take it. Now, some people, some schools, they'll put that foreign language on the transcript just to show a college that they've taken it, but they don't offer them credit for it. So as long as it's offered credit, then it'll be considered by the NCAA. If it's a pass-fail, well, for example, if it's a pass, what they're gonna do is they're gonna look at the lowest possible grade that you can get for passing, which would be a D. So they would give that class a D. And that's with any pass-fail class.
Yeah.
Sure.
So for our students, if you took it in junior high, you know you have to come and take a second class, Spanish 2 or French 2 or whatever, get a C or better in that class, it will then appear on your transcript. So it is a graded course for us, even though it's shown as a transfer on the transcript, and NCAA will take that. Also, be careful, our social studies, a lot of students assume that our consumer ed is a social studies. It is not. It is in our business program, so do not count it as a social studies.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I would also say don't just assume that because of the level that it's automatically accepted. So if it's an honors level, don't just assume, well, it's an honors level, they should take it. Not true.
So other than that, with the core course, any student athlete who graduates on time with their graduating class, so if they graduate with their graduating class, they're allowed to take one additional core course after graduation that can apply to NCAA.
Regardless of ACT, SAT, the scores must be directly sent, of course, just like you would for an application, any other application, directly from the testing agency. You can use the code 9999 for the NCAA or 9876 for the NAIA if you need to send those scores to them. Like I mentioned before, testing accommodations, they are approved, again, based on each situation. And again, we already talked about the LGBT Center using the subscores, you know, from each of the super scoring to get the sum score. Some of the timelines we talk about, students come in and sometimes wait until the end, which most often can be disastrous. We have to actually start them as early as possible. We talked about the Eligibility Center actually sending that information in a little bit later, but it's never too early to start. We always talk to students about planning now, planning ahead. Even if those plans don't work out, at least they have something in place. Communicate with your collegiate wishes, I guess, to coaches and your counselors. Coaches are perhaps the biggest supporters and the best resource for information as you go through this process, although sometimes it's painful information. Many times we get families that will come in and say, I want my son or daughter to play at Duke. And we say, well, have you talked to the coach? Yes, what did he say? Well, he says I should be looking at a junior college level. Okay, listen to the coach. They're the expert in the field. I know sometimes we have disagreements with coaches and all those things, but many times they're looking out hopefully for the best interest of their students. That's why they're in education, and they can be the best indicator. The counselor obviously is another tool that has different resources than the coaches have, and are able to help as well, especially with planning, academic planning, make sure that you're doing everything that you need to. Taking courses from the approved list of courses, working hard on the grades, of course, using summer school if they need to get caught up on a class, again, make sure that class in the summertime is also accepted by the NCAA. Going into the junior years, again, we're working with a counselor, getting the best grades that we can. We're taking the ACT scores, test. We're studying eligibility for the Eligibility Center, send official transcript, and then once again, use a summer school. So pretty basic timeline. I can't encourage them to start early enough, be proactive in the process. It makes it much easier than trying to fix it on the end. I think in the next two slides or slide or so, you're gonna see some changes that are gonna happen in the near future. It's going to make it much more difficult for us to be able to go back and help the student out. They're going to lock some things in. We'll talk about it in a second. Suggested timeline for seniors, get the best grades, take the ACT, review that amateurism questionnaire. One thing we didn't talk a lot about is that amateurism questionnaire. What that is a questionnaire for the family and students to sit down together and ask questions like, have you ever been paid to play, to receive a monetary award of any kind? Do you have a sports agent? Things along those lines. I'm not going to tell you how to answer those questions, but you'll see them as you go through. Make sure that you answer those honestly. It is a big part of it, and it can stop a student from receiving any kind of athletic award. So the official transcript with proof of graduation, you'll send one at the junior year, as we talked about. You must send a final transcript. The NCAA will not finally certify a student until a final transcript has been received. They want to see that they've graduated and what that final grade point average is going to be. So don't forget to send that one at the end. Eligibility registration, they get you for $75. Although I can give it to them, they do a little bit more work. The fee waiver are eligible if they're on free or reduced, or if they've been a fee waiver for the ACT or SAT in the past. You can see your counselor for that as well. This is a final point at the bottom there, that they do certify about 80,000 certifications in those summer months after the senior year. It takes them time to process that. So once you know for sure that you sent that transcript in, give them some time to do that. You also find that if you try to call the NCAA, you may wait on the phone for quite a while. So just be patient with them. Be confident and know that the transcript is sent. Remember that it takes them, even though they've received it in a few days, it may sit on a desk before it's actually processed. And it's similar to the college applications. We have that conversation right now, is that families, we send a transcript, well, they should have it in a couple days. Okay, why isn't it showing? Why am I getting these reminders that I still need a transcript we sent? Be patient, let them have time to put them in, especially with that many certifications coming through.
Once the fall rolls around, the way that the NCAA processes everything is first priority is the students that have just moved on to campus. The freshmen on college campuses, they're going to take first priority, and that's who the NCAA is going to work with first. Because they're on campus, they need to compete ASAP. So they're going to roll through all of those students. Then after that, then that's when they hit the seniors that have sent all their information in. Then they may hit the juniors, depending on how much time they have. So those juniors may sit right on the bottom, and they'll be the last ones to be worked with. If any sophomores send it in, I'm highly doubting that the NCAA will even look at that, because as we said earlier, they're looking at six semesters on a transcript. So,
reminder too that students we work with, different sports, usually call the school or they let the student know that they'd like to see an unofficial transcript. You can always send that coach an unofficial transcript. Let them take a look at it. They have their compliance officers who will begin combing through it as well. And hopefully by that point, maybe even had a counselor look at it and let you know if they are eligible or not. So don't be afraid to send those out as part of the recruiting process. Not a big deal at all.
Yeah, that's what I would give the guidance office clearance that they're okay to send those transcripts out, because what will happen is there's five official visits that a student athlete can take on a Division I, Division II, I do believe, campus. And there's a couple of things that they need to have on file. They need to have the NCAA eligibility sent. They need to have registered for that. Then they also need an unofficial copy of the transcript sent to the college. So those are the two things that they will need in order to do an official visit.
Okay, when do we ask our students to sign up for NCAA? The end of junior year. Unless you're an early eligibility person, the 3.0 or whatever, that you're being recruited freshman or sophomore year, we would like you to request this at the end of junior year, in May, because we will send out all transcripts the middle of June, going to colleges for our seniors, going to NCAA, going anywhere that you need them, but you need to request them in May. They require six semesters, and juniors, how many juniors we have in here? You don't have six semesters till the end of that year. So it doesn't do us any good to send a transcript first semester junior year, because you're gonna have to send a second one sixth semester. To make things even more confusing, our sixth semester actually ends the end of July, because summer school is included in our sixth semester. So if you are taking a course that you want included in a sixth semester to prove what they're going to show you in a few minutes, I think, what your how many required courses need to be completed by a certain time, then you'll have to wait until that July if you really need that course counted as a sixth semester course. Secondly, this amateur eligibility, we have two campuses. It causes us lots of problems, because on your amateur eligibility form, it asks the question, where did you attend 9th and 10th grade? And being the honest folks that we have here at LT, they all say South Campus. What happens? NCAA said they went to a different place freshman and sophomore year. We need a transcript from there. We don't have a transcript from there. We only have a transcript from North Campus. So please lie on the eligibility and say you have never, ever attended South Campus. You have always been at North Campus. It is always that C code 142483. Or what happens is they will keep bugging you to send a transcript. We can't send that. If you do say North Campus, do your eligibility, ask for that transcript at the end of May, I guarantee we will send it out there for you. You'll be all set. You don't have to fill out all kinds of forms. We just list all students who are going to play or be eligible for NCAA, and we'll take care of it for you.
That's a great point. You know, something I missed, Dan alluded to it, is that if a student has taken a course at another school, if they transferred in into the school, you must send a transcript to that school. They will not, NCAA will not look at the transcript that Lyons has transcribed from that other institution. They want to make sure that Leanne didn't doctor a class or change a name of something so that the student was eligible in the long run. So you will need to send one from each school that the student has attended.
All right, here comes the new qualifications for the NCAA student athletes. So this is for the current juniors. So congratulations, juniors. You will be the guinea pigs going into this. So here's the new changes. So for a full qualifier, that's receiving a student that is going to be on campus, receiving aid, being able to practice, being able to compete. The qualifications that they'll have to meet. Core courses stay the same, still have to complete 16 core courses. The changes, one of the changes, is 10 of those 16 core courses must be completed before the seventh semester. So there's going to be 10 courses that are going to need to be completed before then. So if you have 9, you are now not going to be a full qualifier. You may not be a full qualifier. 7 of those 10 core courses must be from English, math, or science. So that's it. That's going to be another one. And the big one is they need to have a minimum core GPA of a 2.3. So before, it was a minimum core of a 2.0. Now they're moving it up to a 2.3. Grades earned in the 10 required courses required before the senior year are locked in. So I don't want to get too in-depth about this, but what the NCAA is able to do right now is, let's say you've taken core courses and you may have gotten a D in one of those courses. Now you take a different, let's say English. You take one of your English classes and you get a D in one of those classes. And now you take maybe like a journalism class, which depending on the school, NCAA accepts that, and you get an A in there. NCAA will take that journalism A and move it to where that English, where you got that D in English. Now with the new rules, they won't do that. It's going to be locked in, so even if you take an extra English course, they're not going to move that in and replace it. So That's going to be a big one with that. A repeat of one of the locked in courses will not be used to improve the GPA. So again, I know for our high school, the only way you can retake a class is if you fail it. So now that's going to be the interesting thing to see how that works, because if a student fails that class and then they go in and retake it, I believe, depending on the school, if they keep that F on the transcript, that may stay in there. So, and then they meet the competition sliding scale requirement of the GPA and the ACT. So that there is a new sliding scale, which is in the booklet as well. So you can take a look at that. They compare the old scale to the new scale, so you can look at the difference with that. And then the same as always, graduate from high school. So those are some of the, that's going to be the big changes for the current juniors. Now there's going to be a new criteria, which is going to be the academic redshirt. So pretty much what the academic redshirt is they can go to the college, they can receive aid, they can practice, but they can't compete. And that's pretty much if a student meets the old, or the current, I should say, the current NCAA requirements right now. So that minimum of a 2.0. So that if their core GPA is not at a 2.3, it's below a 2.3, now they're in the academic redshirt area. They still have to complete 16 core courses, they still have to meet the sliding scale, and they still need to graduate from high school. But now there's a difference between the academic redshirt and a full qualifier. And then the third one is non-qualifier. Non-qualifier is a non-qualifier. Same as it is now, same as it will be in the future. If you haven't met the NCAA requirements and you're going to be considered a non-qualifier, Can't receive aid, can't practice, can't compete. So those are the wonderful new changes of the NCAA coming down the pipeline for the current juniors.
Next question we always get asked, how do students recruit themselves? Just a few tips up here. Obviously, the coaches, and working in admissions office, I saw this quite a bit. Coaches want the student that they don't have to babysit. So we always say grades are so important. You're a student first, athlete second. Work hard at the sport, setting yearly goals to get to the next step. Work with their coaches, we mentioned that. Understand the role of the coach. Register with the Eligibility Center and identify colleges that are compatible and that you fit into. So the biggest thing that you can do. A couple other ideas, or at least one big idea that I asked students to do in the past, and I learned this a few years ago, is YouTube videos. If your student can make some tape of themselves with some help, maybe the AV club or someone at home, it doesn't have to be a lot. But in that video, you want to make sure that you share, first of all, grades should be the foremost. That should be the reason that the coach is hopefully talking to you. A little bit about the student activities that they're involved in, their sport that they're involved in, and then make some clips. Either I'm a golf coach, there's their swing. Swing with 100 yards out and 75 yards out, you're putting, all those elements. They don't have to be long clips, just enough to get them an idea. The reason I say YouTube videos, you can send that off to the coaches. They can take a look at it on the road traveling, wherever they're at on their phone, whatever they're doing. Just makes it very easy to do that. The other thing I tell families is remember that coaches will remember you the more that they hear from you. And I caution you with this, is don't be a pain, but it's also known that if you are contacting them often, that you're interested in their program, you know what they're doing, you know what the stats are of that program, they're going to realize that you're a student that's actually committed to coming to that to their program. Remember, they want to recruit, students that are going to make their jobs easy as well. And if they're babysitting that student, they're worried about what's on Facebook or social media. Another big one for the way for the coach to check up on a student without actually having contact with them are the Facebook pages. So please be careful, students, with that as well. I know you hear that all the time, but it is something that the coaches do use. I heard Pat Fitzgerald talk about it, Northwestern football coach, on how they use that as part of their recruiting tool when they're looking at students. So please be careful with that. I always tell a quick story about my process and how I received a scholarship. Coaches had called, offered me a scholarship. My family and I were hoping for a little bit more money. We needed money to help pay for some school. I went out and signed up at the junior college. It's about a month and a half before school had started. The coach had already offered me a tender. I hadn't signed it, sat on the table in the kitchen. About a week before classes start, coach calls and says, hey, we're really excited. What day are you coming to campus? And I said, coach, maybe I should have called and told you. I kind of knew at this process, but I'm not coming. I signed up. I'm going to the junior college. And he said, what do you mean? I said, well, financially, it just didn't make sense for my family and I right now. He said, if I could get you more money, would you think about coming? I said, well, I don't know. It depends on how much more money that is. He called back 15 minutes later, and I said, I'll be there in a week. Where do you want me? I tell you that with caution. I played the game, and I didn't know that I was even playing a game. There is money out there to be had. Remember, they try to save money in their pockets for their programs to offer to other students. If you feel like the student is not receiving money, there's nothing wrong with asking for more. Where it gets into a bad situation is demanding for more. And that coach suddenly says, well, I have a student here that I don't have to have this discussion with, and I can go with that student and not have a problem with that. So take caution with it, but also use it as good advice and ways to work with those coaches. I encourage students and families to sit down with coaches as much as they can before they sign a letter of intent. Once your student has left high school, if you haven't been there before, my experience was that college athletics was a lot different than high school athletics. I loved high school athletics. I had a wonderful coach. Now, they didn't have a wonderful coach in college. It's just that when someone is paying you to be there, expectations are much, much different. There's not many sick days. There's just different demands that are put on the student, and it was not as enjoyable for me. Make sure that you're asking questions of the coach like, what is your contract like? How long will you be here? If you recruit my child, are you going to leave in 2 years? And we're left with a brand new coach coming in with a whole new coaching style that doesn't match with my son or daughter. Ask them what the expectations are for second, sophomore, junior year. Is there a chance for more academic money or athletic money? Ask them things like, how many seniors do you have? Who's leaving the program as my child's coming in? Gives you an idea what kind of money's going to be there in the future. Don't be afraid to ask those questions. I fear the families who don't sit down with those coaches and have those conversations, that somewhere down the road things may break up a little bit. Don't be afraid to ask the hard questions of them, and if they spurt them, it may be a really good sign that there's something else, some other agenda going on there at the school or with the coach. Anything I'm missing with that?
I don't think so. I think unlike Brad, though, I had a fantastic college career. I loved every opportunity. I loved being a Division III student athlete. Not that Brad didn't enjoy it, but I loved it. I think back to the days, and it was awesome. So, but I think the reason why I'm saying that is because it falls into that last place. Identify colleges compatible for you. One thing I tell students is when you're going out, and I should say families as well, but specifically the student athlete, when you're stepping on that campus, you want to look around at that campus and look at it and go, okay, if I didn't have this sport, would I still stay on this campus? And if the answer is yes, then that's probably the school for you. But if you're going for the coach, as Brad said, remember that that coach is human, and we've all seen how many coaches are shifting and moving, and there's not as much loyalty as there used to be back in the day. So that coach more than likely could up and leave. So don't go to school for the coach. Go to the school for the school. Make sure it has everything that you're looking for. And I think this is really self-explanatory. That's all most counselors will always talk about, finding that right fit, getting on those campuses, visiting, and seeing if that's the right fit for you.
I did enjoy my experience immensely. I had a great time. Made some great friends, but like I said, the expectations were just much different than what they were in high school.
You would have had a lot better experience if you would have went to the finer institution of Loras College in Dubuque, Iowa.
No, it's not good.
And then we would have been best of friends.
Yeah.
One other thing, and I think Mr. Kane kind of aged himself. Students, how many of you guys still use Facebook? That's what I thought. Okay, yeah, Mr. Kane aged himself. So, however, the Twitter, the Instagram, all that other wonderful stuff, college coaches will find all of that stuff. You think you're hidden, you're not hidden. When I was at Lincoln Way, there was a wonderful receiver who I thought was wonderful, who was being recruited by one of our institutions that I think everybody knows, but it will rename nameless. It's probably the biggest school in the state of Illinois. He was being recruited by that school. The college coach at that time, who this kid I thought was a wonderful student, there were some shady things that he was saying on Twitter, and the college coach came down just for a visit, just to see how things were going, sat down with him. Kid sits down, and this head coach sits down right in front of him and says, you know, they're having conversation back and forth, and the last thing he says, hey, by the way, I saw what you were posting on Twitter. Knock that stuff off and get off of it. The size of that kid's eyeballs when the coach said that was awesome. So, as I said, college coaches will always find that. And I think a big piece of what Brad was talking about is, of course, the grades, but it's also the character. College coaches want a character student on their campus as well. So it's easier to recruit a student who has great grades, has a great ACT score, but also has a great attitude about things. And college coaches, I've known that college coaches to call me when I was a general counselor and say, hey, you know what? I want to talk to you specifically. We've talked to the coach before. We've talked to his high school coach. I want to talk to you about his character. Have you known anything that he's done that we would question pretty much? And, you know, of course, I'm not going to say anything bad. Luckily, the kid who they were calling about, the kid was a wonderful kid. So I said, no, this kid's awesome. Yeah, I think you'll love him. But college coaches will do that. College coaches will call. I've got a student right now. She just signed, track athlete. She just signed with U of I, full ride. College coaches are calling me every single day at U of I asking about her character. And I think also with that, we'll talk about that as well, that wonderful story. She is a student who is a borderline kid, still working on being NCAA eligible. And the college coaches are calling me just about every single day, asking me about her grades. I have to have weekly checkups with them. I'm sending grades. So the one thing you want to do, and I don't think we mentioned this, is one of the things college coaches will always say, I'll take care of you. Don't worry about it. Give me the application. We'll take care of it. Until you guys get an actual acceptance letter from the admissions office, you are not accepted into that school. And this athlete right now that has a full ride to U of I, she's not accepted to U of I yet. And I still have to send grades every single week. And depending on how long, they want to see how her seventh semester goes. And if she slips that second semester, and we're talking even a C, she's probably not going to get admitted. So she was all excited when we signed last week, and I said, congratulations. However, you have not received your acceptance letter yet, so don't get too excited. So
there's a reason that it's called the athletic department and the admission office.
Yep.
Two separate entities. 100%, Kevin. So many times we've heard, we'll take care of it. Things get, then the coach loses son, doesn't make it to the admission office, or something has changed. Admission counselor says, no, I can't accept that student. Now all of a sudden we've got a student that is not being recruited. And the problem with it is many times it happens in May.
Yes.
When we found out that the admissions office is saying, no, you're not admitted. And now you're sitting there looking and going, it's May, all the admission deadlines have passed. Now what am I going to do? So absolutely make sure you're working with that admission office closely as well.
ED, early decision. Address early decision. With early decision, there is, with that, you're meaning with athletics, Leanne? Yeah, a lot of students are pushed to apply, a lot of the athletes, college coaches will push them to apply ED, just so they can lock them in. And because with ED, and I don't know if you guys are aware with ED, if you get admitted to that school, you're canceling all your other applications and going with this one school. So college coaches may push your student to go ED. If you are not 100% sure that that's the school that you want to go to,
the other problem is financially they've got a big checker in their pocket, because ED, they can require to pay upfront 100%. They don't have to receive any kind of financial assistance. Early action, much differently, just acting early, early decision is legally binding. So the coach can then say, well, we don't have to give you any money. You've already made the ED decision. You're coming here regardless of what I give you money or not. So be very cautious when you make those early decisions.
Luckily, I haven't dealt with any students that have fallen into that situation, but you never know. There's a lot of different strategic ways that coaches will lock you guys in. So just make sure to go through the process thoroughly, and that's what the guidance office is for, is to help you guys through that process as well. One other piece that I tell students to do is, every school has some kind of athletic questionnaire on their website. Go on there, fill out the athletic questionnaire. But then, after you fill out that athletic questionnaire, every single website has a college coach's contact information. Send them a quick email. Hey, I'm interested in your school. I just filled out your athletic questionnaire. I just wanted to let you know that I'm interested in possibly attending your institution, competing for such and such sport. If you have any questions, let me know. That get you on the recruiting trail for that certain coach. So that's another thing that I would say. I only say that because some college coaches have said that all I do is look at the athletic questionnaires. If a student fills out an athletic questionnaire, they go on our recruiting list. Other coaches have said, I don't even deal with the athletic questionnaire. They can fill it out, but it gets lost in the shuffle. Other coaches will say, absolutely, I'm going to take an email over it, filling out an athletic questionnaire, because the email is more genuine. It's directed straight towards the coach. So that's why I say, if you cover both bases, then you're good. You're good to go. Other than that, continue to communicate with the target schools. I think when you're deep and heavy into the recruiting process, I always tell families to be honest with the coach. Hopefully that coach is going to be honest with you as well. So as long as you guys are having that communication both ways, a good coach and a good program will let you know. this is how many, this is, your student is one of our top recruits, or, you know what, we're looking at such and such different, so many other different recruits, your son or daughter is number such and such on our list. We had a student last year that graduated and Harvard was looking at her. They're recruiting five kids, she was number six, and she was a softball player, and she was ticked. But I told the family, I said, hey, you know what, at least he's being honest with you and letting you know that, you know what, this is where we're looking at, and if those other five don't end up panning out, then she would move into that top five. But college coaches, hopefully the good ones will be honest with you. Hopefully all of them are going to be honest with you, but the good ones will definitely let you know where their program is sitting, what they're looking for, and where your son or daughter is being recruited at. Stay focused, continue to work hard in those academics. Can't stress that one enough. And other than that, that is it. So any questions that you guys have for us? Sure.
Last year, my daughter got a lot of letters of intent from colleges, and I didn't know how to respond as a freshman. What should you do with those letters?
Letters of interest. All right, letters of interest, I'll be honest with you. Here's what college coaches do. They throw out a wide net to a whole lot of students, and they will see what they can bring in. I would say, you know, when you get those letters, do the research. See if it's something that you're interested in. One thing you can do is you, if you have any certain questions or any questions about the program, reach out to the coach and just send them an email. The problem is, this is how coaches can contact a student that, because pretty much they can't make contact until pretty much their junior year. So in order for them to make contact earlier in the game, they'll send out this wide net and send letters out to student athletes. If you make the initiative and contact the coach, they can reply back, but they can't be the one that makes the initial contact. So as far as calling or emailing, they can't be the ones that shoot an email out to you. But from there, do the research, and then I would say never throw anything out. Do the research. With my process, Lawrence was a school that had been recruiting me. They'd been sending me letters, and I had been throwing them out in the garbage. I said, there's no way I'm going to Lawrence College. I don't know what Lawrence College is. I don't know where Dubuque, Iowa is. I grew up in the Chicagoland area. There was no way that I thought I was going to the cornfields of Iowa. And ended up being a school that I ended up going to and loving. So I always tell students to keep their options open, but do the research. And from there, approach it cautiously. Because like I said, I'm being honest. They're just going to throw out a wide net. But you can definitely do the research. And if you have any questions, reach back to them.
I always tell families as well, if you're going or planning on getting some of these mailings, you maybe want to visit one of these schools if they're local, or you can get out there and see them. Don't be afraid to reach out to a coach and say, hey, I got some information from you. I'd like to know if I can stop by and say hello.
Right.
You can pay for yourself to go to that campus, sit down and talk with the coach for a few minutes. What you can't do is you can't get on the court and practice with them. You can't take part of anything that would be happening as their team. I always tell students, and you have to be very cautious when you do that, a track person, you want to throw a pair of spikes in the car and run along the track while the coach happened to walk past, might not be a bad way to help yourself out as you first time meeting those coaches. Other questions?
The contact times, by the way, are in the handbook that I gave you, when a coach can approach you, and as they said, you can always approach a coach first. I tell you that I get probably 200 letters that are sent to students to me, because they can't send them to you.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have your address.
Yep.
They know that you have a student in a particular sport. I give those to Mr. Grucky, who disseminates them to the different coaches. So have your students ask every so often, have I gotten any letters? Sometimes those are very viable letters. Often they're way, you know, a kid saying with a 2.0, boy, Harvard wants them. They don't know that much about you, so you're going to have to go ahead and initiate some correspondence if you're interested in pursuing it.
We had a question out here. Will they take honors weighted grades differently than a regular level? And yes, they will. They will give weighting for extra point value if their student falls on one of those honor scales. Yes.
On page 39, it talks about that scholarships.
There you go.
Athletic scholarships are awarded to 1 year and they're renewable, and that they can be canceled or reduced for any reason. Is that actually true?
Absolutely.
So if you don't perform or you get injured.
Absolutely. That's a great question to ask that coach. What if I get hurt? What happened to my scholarship? Remember, we hear students say this all the time. I got a 4-year scholarship to XYZ school. No, you didn't. You got a 1-year tenure that you signed with that coach, right? After that's renewed, if you're performing well. Now, most of the time, I very rarely ever hear a student losing that scholarship. The key to it is if you're hurt and the coach is asking you to be the scorekeeper for that year, then you're going to be the scorekeeper because that's your scholarship. So be very cautious. Ask those coaches that question. Have any of your students not received scholarships after their freshman year? Have you dropped them from the program? And if so, why? What did they do that made them lose that tenure? So great question.
I was at a meeting with Pat Fitzgerald where they were talking about the underbelly of Division I sports. And one of those things was just that. You're not working out at the D1 level. Guess what? This is a big time sport. We're going to see if we can trade you to a nice D3 team who needs a really good player but not good enough for us. And that does happen. It doesn't mean you might totally lose out on money. They may offer you some money through their own division, their own school, their own talent. But the NCAA has, I think Northwestern, started trying to get together a players union for that very reason. They wanted to say, if you want us, we want to know that we're going to be there for all 4 years, as opposed to this yearly contract that's now been in place for many years and continues to be in place.
Another good point, too. I was at the same presentation. And one of the things that Pat talked about was, you know, he gets these phone calls from families that their students want to play for him. How do we know when we're going to be recruited? And correct me if I'm wrong. He said, if you're not hearing from us by your sophomore year, you're not going to play on the team. More than likely, you're not going to be recruited for a scholarship for that. So when you look at those big-time programs, your son or daughter, it hasn't heard from them. More than likely, it's going to be an uphill battle for them. I'm not going to say it's impossible. Walk-on scholarships happen. Walk-on positions happen. But the dreams sometime are quickly brought to an end. So throw that net out there also for yourselves to make sure that there's good possibilities.
On the other hand, what does happen is there are a lot of very good colleges that are D1 or D3 and end up recruiting our students at the end of the year. These students weren't even looking at these schools, and all of a sudden the guy shows up and he says, you know what, I'm from the University of Redlands in California, I'm looking for a swimmer, I hear you're good. And they come and recruit them, and the students were not prepared. They weren't prepared academically because they keep looking at 2.3 as their total GPA and not their core courses. Some students have had IEPs and thought, I'm going to take that little lower level class because I'm not going to push too hard. I don't need any more than I have to graduate. You never know. If you're an athlete, always think, if I really think I'm going to play sports in college, I need to do the best academic work. We've had students take a class such as geometry that is not accepted. We have a geometry course that is not acceptable in the core course requirement. There's nothing wrong with taking that course. It prepares you for the next level geometry course, but you have to take that course. If you don't, you're short of math class. Things like that. Stay on top of those courses, know what you need by what date, and be ready to play even if you don't get recruited. Walk-ons happen too.
It's one of the most painful conversations for us to have is that student that comes in and didn't do what they should have their first or second year. And there's no way, as you saw earlier, that go back and correct those things, regardless how good an athlete they are. In the past, maybe some of those athletes slipped through and somehow you had very low test scores and low grade point average to find them playing at these big programs. It does not happen any longer, especially with some of the problems they've had in the past with the eligibility center. They've really cleaned it up, and also with the compliance officers at the college level to make sure that doesn't happen any longer. I think we're about done. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
Just a continuation on that, because I know many sports have much fewer scholarships that they're allowed to give than kids on the team. What prevents the coach from saying, yeah, we'll give you something freshman year and we'll just see how it works out. And you're not so good, you're not getting anything for the rest of the year, or the rest of the years you're there. Like swimming, for example, you've got 10 scholarships or 8 scholarships, and you got a team of 20 kids.
Yeah, it could definitely happen. Absolutely. So, but it's I think I've seen it more on the other side, and that's where I was talking about. Hopefully that coach is going to be honest with you, and I've seen it more where they say, okay, you know what, we're not going to be able to offer you a scholarship right now, but you'll get here, you'll earn pretty much earn your scholarship, and then from there you'll go, you'll receive a scholarship from then on out. But yeah, it absolutely happens. But I would say also to caution that if a student receives a scholarship and then gets it taken away, that's really not looking good on the program, not looking good on that coach. So more than likely that coach doesn't want to be put in that situation, because that word spreads pretty quickly, and there'll be other student athletes that'll go, hey, I remembered you offered that student a scholarship and then took it away from them, so why would I even go to your institution? So it could happen that way as well.
Which is another great tip: when the student's on campus, check things out, maybe meet with the coach, ask to see if you can meet with some of the athletes. They're a great indicator of what the team is like and what the coach, how the coach treats the rest of the team. They'll be brutally honest with you normally.
Yeah.
Tell you exactly what's going on. We'll stick around for a few minutes. Anybody has any questions? Thanks for coming. Good luck to you. And if you need anything,
please,
our contact.
Join me in thanking Brad and Kevin. And especially Brad, who has a brand new baby at home and came anyway, and I really wanted to wanted to help us out. If you are staying for the next one, Selective College Night is going to start at 7:15. There are some materials in the front that I would like you to pick up. There are restrooms up on the second floor of men's and ladies, or down in the basement if you would like to use those, and we're going to start shortly.